it's shocking to me that of all the newspapers and news outlets in this country, none of them have ever investigated this. It's shocking. Let me just show you this. I'm winding down. I'm almost done. This is a 2000 investigation by the U.S. House Government Reform Committee. All these are quotations from it, and it's talking about the corruption in the two committees, the committee at FDA that licenses all vaccines. It's not a committee made up of FDA people. They're people that are brought in from the industry. They license the vaccines based upon this non-existent science. Then it goes to another committee called ACIP in the CDC, and they add it to the schedule again. And all of them have financial ties to the industry. This is a typical, anyway, this is, look at this. This is, for example, three of the five FDA advisory committees on VRBPAC who voted to approve the rotavirus vaccine in December 97 had financial ties to the pharmaceutical companies that were developing different versions of the vaccines. One of the five voting members' employer had a $9 million contract for a rotavirus vaccine. One of the five voting members was a principal investigator for a Merck grant to develop a rotavirus vaccine. One of the five voting members received $1 million from vaccine manufacturers toward vaccine development. Those are the guys who mandated, who licensed the rotavirus vaccine that your kids have to take. And this is ACIP, which now you go to the CDC. ACIP admits it did not adopt evidence-based guidelines for recommending vaccines into 2011. That raised the question, what were they basing it on? Just relationships. That's it. And I'll show you the relationships. And by the way, virtually all the vaccines we have, like Gardasil and MMR, were already done. And these two committees have brought this from a $1 billion industry in 86 to a $50 billion today, and that's why we're getting all these vaccines. Now, here is a congressional investigation of the CDC side that mandates the vaccines. The chairman, the majority of the eight ACIP members were conflicted. The chairman served on Merck's advisory board. Another member shares the patent on a vaccine under development for the very same disease, had a $350,000 grant to develop this vaccine. You know who this was? Paul Offit. He owned the patent, he voted it on, then he sold his patent back to Merck for $186 million. And he's the darling of the media in this country. He can publish editorials every 6 months in the New York Times, and people die to get him on their shows. Another member was under contract with the Merck Vaccine Division, received funds from various vaccine manufacturers, including Pasteur, was under contract. Another member received a salary from Merck. Another member was participating in vaccine studies with Merck. Another member received grants from Merck and SmithKline. This is to approve a vaccine that Merck owned the patent for. So, now, in case you think, well, that was an anomaly, this is 11 years later, the HHS Office Inspector General says 97% of committee members had failed to make conflict disclosures. At least 58% had an unidentified potential conflict, and 32% had conflicts. Hey, this is CDC's budget, $11.5 billion, but $5 billion of that goes to vaccine sales and promotion. And by the way, this is how much they spent on safety, $20 million. The tail is wagging the dog. Okay. Here's the woman who brought us the MMR monopoly. She brought us the Gardasil vaccine with all that crappy science. Her name is Julie Gerberding. She was head of CDC from 2002 to 2009. She's the one that silenced Bill Thompson when he tried to talk. He went to her. She had him chased into the parking lot and, you know, threatened by Robert Chen. And in 2010, she got her reward. She became president of Merck's vaccine division 1 year after she stepped down and gave him the Gardasil. And she got $2.5 million in annual salary and $38 million in stock options. That was her bribe for giving Gardasil to all our little girls and poisoning them. $38 million to Julie Gerby. Yeah, that's why Yale didn't show up. That's the amount of money that has been paid out by the vaccine court. Okay, I'm just going to show you a couple more slides I put on the end here. And again, this is IOM saying you have never studied autism. And this one is actually, oh, that's 91. This is, you've all seen this. You know, the industry of love school claim, we erase measles. This is actually what happened. And you can do this for virtually all infectious diseases. They were erased by hygiene, sewage treatment, chlorine, and good food. And this is what happened. This is when the vaccine was introduced, 1963. Okay, I said MMR was never safety tested. They didn't even do one of those two-day jobs. They have nothing. You look on their insert and look for safety testing, there's nothing there. They were never safety tested. They legally have to say if they were, and they weren't. So we know that the MMR causes a lot of injuries. And, you know, it's one of the vaccines that causes more injuries than others, and it causes, I think, six times the amount of seizures that actual measles does. We don't know, but measles vaccine saves lives, because when it was introduced in 1963, the year before in 1962, 408 Americans died from measles. So we can assume that 400 Americans are saved by this vaccine every year. The question we don't know is, are more people dying? And that's really what we have to answer to do a cost-benefit analysis. That's what science should do. Should tell us, is this a cost-benefit analysis, and could we do better with a single measles vaccine? Could we improve those odds? But that's, nothing like that is ever studied, and that's the problem. They don't study it. So this is recent studies that have come out that show that if you get measles when you're young, you are much less likely to get cancer when you're older, certain kinds of cancer. This is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. This is Hodgkin's lymphoma. These are all recent studies. You can find this PowerPoint on our website under this, and you can look at all of these studies. Childhood diseases affect NHL and AHL lists. That's not Hodgkin's lymphoma. This shows if I'm not having measles, you have an additional chance of getting, a 40% chance of getting non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And not having a wild measles infection. And for a Hodgkin's lymphoma, it's a 230% greater chance. The estimated deaths in 2018, a lot of people die from these diseases, but we don't know how many of those are from not getting measles. Here's a Japanese study. Also, that last study was for heart disease and ovarian cancer, but heart disease is dramatically less than if you had measles. This is cardiovascular disease. It's a Japanese study of deaths from cardiovascular disease. The black line is from people who had no infections, neither measles nor mumps. These are mortality statistics. And you can see they're dramatic. This is after 22 years after the vaccines were given, or after the aid. Follow-up years after the vaccine was given. 22 years, or after the disease was contracted. 22 years later, this is the mortality. The people in this line, which are by far the most long-lived, are people who had both wild mumps and measles infections. These are the ones who got vaccinated and didn't. So the death rate 22 years later is dramatic. It's like a third. What can I say about that? The only other thing I can say is, shouldn't this be studied?
Yes.
You know, I can't say anything else except that shouldn't our government agencies be studying this? Shouldn't we be forcing the industry to study this? And that's the problem, is we have all of these, this science out there that is very suggestive, but we don't have any real answers. Anyway, that is it for that PowerPoint.